For this video, we're going to take a look at how you will solve a compound inequality, such as the one that you see right here, and only use your calculator. We will not be doing this algebraically. We're going to first start by using the TI 89 to solve our equation. And when we do that, we are going to go ahead and put this part here in what will be Y1 in a calculator. We will put this part here, which is the middle part of the compound inequality, for Y2. And this part here in Y3. Let's look at how you will do that. First, turn your calculator on. And to get into the screen that you see right here, you press the green button and F1, because above F1, you see y equals. Then what we're going to do is just type negative 2 into our calculator and hit enter, and notice that shows up in the Y1 section of our screen. It also has a check mark next to it up here. If you press F4, if you have it highlighted, and press F4, that check mark will go away. If you press F4 again, that check mark will come back. If there is a check mark, then that will actually show up on our graph. And y equaling negative 2 will be a horizontal line on our graph. Now, if I arrow down to y2, we're going to type in 2, and then use x on your keyboard, and minus 4. Also, make sure when you do your negative on the 2 up here, that rather than doing the minus, you use the negative symbol down below here. If you use a minus, you'll get an error in your calculator. Now entering our Y3, we need 8. We're going to be looking where the horizontal line of y equaling negative 2 and the horizontal line of y equaling 3, we're going to look at where those compare to this middle value here. And since we want this middle value here to be less than or equal to the 8, and we want it to be greater than or equal to the 2, we're specifically going to be looking for when this here is between the horizontal line for negative 2 and the horizontal line for 8. Now, we have our equations entered into our calculator. We need to be able to see them in the graph. To do that, we need to make sure we set our window so that it is appropriate for this graph. In order for negative 2 and 8 to show up, we should be fine with what's called a standard window. So press your green button and then F2, which has window in green above it. You can go straight to a standard window by choosing number 6 here, which is zoom standard. Or you can, if you're just press F2, you'll get to zoom and be able to do that. Or you can press the green button and F2 for window and type in negative 10, enter, 10, enter, 1 for your X scale, negative 10 for your Y minimum, ten for your y maximum, and then a 1 for your y scale. You don't need to worry about this thing that says x res. You should be fine without that. And let me correct my y min, or negative 10. This is what a standard window will automatically go to. You can either type it in. Make sure, again, you use the negative button for your negative symbol, not the subtraction. The subtraction will give you an error on your calculator. Once you have this entered in by either doing zoom standard or changing your window, we can go ahead and click the green button and graph. This is the line y equals negative 2, and that is your middle part of 2x minus 4. And then up here we have our horizontal line of y equals 8. We want to know when this slanted line, which is the 2x minus 4, is in between these two horizontal lines. And that's from right here over to right here. Our interval notation is going to start here, where it looks like x is 1, and continue on over to here, where it looks like x is 6. Now, it looks like that, but we're not positive, and there's a way to have your calculator tell you the exact value for each of these intersections. In this case, we only care about the x-coordinate, because our answers are going to be the x values. So we need the x-coordinate at this intersection. We also need the x-coordinate at this intersection, because that's when the line 2x minus 4 is between the negative 2 and the 8. So to find those intersections, we need this thing up here that says map. And notice it says F5 next to it. So we click F5. And number 5, notice, says intersection. That's what we want. You can either arrow down to it using the arrow keys, or you can just press 5 on the keyboard. And notice right now that it has a cursor on this horizontal line for y equals negative 2. And it is flashing, and it asks you if this is the first curve. If we're going for this intersection right here, that is completely fine. So we'll hit enter. And now it has moved over to the slanted line. And if we want this intersection, then yes, that is the second curve. So we hit enter. Lower bound is asking us to have the cursor to the left of our intersection. And notice on my graph, it is to the left. If it wasn't, I could just arrow over and notice it will move farther to the left using this left arrow key. I'm going to click enter and notice a little triangle shows up here that tells me where my lower bound is. And now it's asking for an upper bound. The upper bound means we need to be to the right of that intersection. So use the right arrow key to arrow over so that you are visibly to the right of that intersection. And when you hit enter, another triangle would show up really fast, but it flashed off. And it comes back with the intersection. Notice that the x-coordinate is 1 at that intersection. So that means that our lower bound on our answer is going to be positive 1. In interval notation, we will use a square bracket for that with 1 and a comma. The square bracket is used because right here we have an inequality symbol with a line under it for where the intersection should have been negative 2. Going back to our graph, we now need to find this other intersection over here. So we're going to go back to F5 and we're going to go down to intersection. And now notice that the flashing cursor is on this line y equals negative 2, and this intersection does not involve that one. So I can arrow up, and notice it now jumps to my other line. And that other line is the one that we want. So we'll hit enter. And now notice the second curve that it has gone to back to our y equals negative 2. We don't want that one, so I'm going to arrow over just a little bit and jump up. And then jump up again until the cursor is on the slanted line, which is the one that I want. And then I hit enter. Now my lower bound needs to be to the left of this intersection, and it is, so I'll go ahead and hit enter. And I need to go find an upper bound. So I need to arrow to the right until my cursor passes that intersection. I'll hit enter. And it's going to come back, and notice the x-coordinate here is 6 when our y was 8, which is the horizontal line there. So that means that our slanted line is between these two from 1 here all the way up to 6, which means on our notation, we're going to put a 6 for the last item that we come to, and because our symbol over here has a line under it, we will again use a square bracket for our interval notation. In set notation, this is all the values where x is between and including 1 and 6. So this would be the statement we would use, and then you would use a straight line for such that
mx in front of it, and put all this in between set brackets. This statement is read the set of all x such that 1 is less than or equal to x, which is also less than or equal to 6. And that would be the solution that we get from this graph.
Now, this is the same solution we will get if we use a Casio Classpad. Let's look at how you enter that into the Casio. On the Casio, you first need to get to this screen. If you're in the menu, which looks like this, you can get there by touching the graph table section. And then you will enter in your y equals. And our y equals for our first one will be negative 2. Again, use the negative symbol in order to enter that, and hit exe for execute. Then type in your 2x minus 4 and hit execute. Notice the check marks are showing up on these. You can use your stylus pen to just touch those if you want to deactivate them, or touch them again if you want them activated. Let's go ahead and enter our last one, which is 8, and then execute. Now, notice all three are checked, so they will all show up in our window. If we want them to look different in the Casio so that we can tell them apart, you can click this little line over here and change how they look. So maybe I want the one that I'm looking for to be between the other two to be broken and thick so I can tell what it is. And maybe I want the other one to be thick so I can tell it from the other two. The negative 2 will be a thin line. The 2x minus 4 is going to show up as a dotted line and quite thick. And the 8 will show up as a thick line, and I'll be able to tell the difference. Now, if you just use your stylus pen and click this graph symbol, notice our graphs show up. And if we need to change this window once they show up here, you can click this button here where you have four arrows going out, and that will allow you to change everything. And you can just click wherever you want to change with your stylus pen and type in whatever you wanted. Keep in mind, when you put negatives in, you do need to push the negative symbol. And this dot thing that you have right here, just ignore that. You don't need to change that at any time. It'll just be fine the way that it is. And click OK, and it's all there. Now we need to find the intersections so that we can come up the 1 and the 6 that we did in the TI. So what we're going to do is go to Analysis, Resolve, and Intersect. Now, on this particular one, we do need to go ahead and tell it which ones we want to calculate, because on this one here, we have 3. If there was only 2, it would automatically give you an answer, and if there was more than one answer, you can use your directional thing here to arrow back and forth between them. However, on this one, since there's 3, we need to click Enter, and then Enter again. Notice the first one, we have a little box here that's saying we selected this horizontal line here, and now it's on this one here, which in the little window here, you can tell which one it's on. If I click Enter again, it'll give me the intersection for just those 2. And notice the X was 1 at this spot, just like it was when we did our TI. Now I need this other intersection. If we didn't have 3 of them, you wouldn't have to go back to Analysis. You could just arrow over. But there are 3 of them. So we go Analysis, GSolve, Intersect. And now notice the flashing cursor is on this horizontal line at negative 2. We don't want that. So we're going to use the directional things to arrow to one of the others. And I arrowed up, and now it's on this one here, which is one that I do want. So I'll click Enter. And now it's flashing again over here on this one, which I don't want. So I'm going to arrow down, and notice now it's on the slanted one, which I do want. So I hit Enter, and it's going to come back right here at 6 for an X, which is the same thing we got in the other calculator. You only have to go back to Analysis and GSolve for a second intersection if you have more than one. Otherwise, you won't have to do that. And again, even though we use this calculator, you will write your solution the same way we did here and here for the TI.